And listen as our choir sings The Cornerstone. Thank you so much, choir. Take your hymnals once again, please. Turn to page 353. 353 while I catch my breath here. Stand with us and let's sing Victory in Jesus, page 353. Sing that first. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning, then repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. As the instruments play through that a time or two, get around and shake hands with your neighbor. Tell them you're glad to have them here with us this morning, and sing that second verse with us. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. And right now we have Teresa to come sing for you.
Watching for you and for It's a blessing to see the young ones stepping up their service, isn't it? Last week at the Fifth Sunday Sing, little Lyric was up there on the piano, and she was singing and playing all at one time. And so what a blessing to watch the little ones come along. And some of the little ones aren't so little anymore. They're singing in the senior choir, and it's a blessing to see that. Well, welcome to church today. It's good to see you all here today. I know we've got at least one first-time visitor, and you know they say that throughout the world, you got three or four people that look exactly like you. That's not Lyle. It looks a lot like my little brother Lyle. But this is Michael Hansen. Good to have you with us today, Michael. Thank you for being here. Anyone else for the first time in our services today? All right, got the good old regulars for the rest of you. A couple of prayer requests to mention this morning. We got a text from Brenda Sweers, that's Pam's daughter-in-law, Pam and Jeff's daughter-in-law. Her nephew out in Arizona is 8 years old, I believe, and had some stomach intestine problems, and they got him to the hospital, and he had a bowel blockage and got in for some emergency exploratory surgery. He's out now, but they're expecting a couple of days in ICU and a week or so in the hospital. So let's pray for Josiah and ask that the Lord sort all of that out and that he doesn't have any long-term effects from that. But it's a blessing to hear that the surgery went at least moderately well today, and we'll see how things develop in the coming days. But if you'd hold him up in prayer, we would appreciate that. We heard a little update on Norm this morning. Norm seems to be doing well. Nina, anything you care to add to that this morning? Amen. Amen. That's a blessing to hear as well. And then Grandma's nephew, Brad, I think it was probably 2 weeks ago in church we mentioned, 1 week ago in church we mentioned that he needed a whole lot of blood to the tune of 4 pints, something like that. And one of our medical professionals in the building here said that you only have 5 or 6 pints in your body. Is that right? Quarts. I don't know what those measurements are. I know what a gallon looks like, and everything else is a mystery. Whatever it was, he needed a lot of blood. And so he's got 2 artificial knees, and they're trying to make sure the infection doesn't get down to his knees, but that's Brad. So if you'd be praying for him as well. And then I guess one last update, Papa saw Billy Dunnigan out for a ride the other day. So she made it into a car, at least got out of the house a little bit, but I guess she's feeling about the same. Still not feeling strong enough to get here, so keep on praying for Billy, and you know, we certainly miss her here. Coming events, February 15th, that is 10 days away, so that's a week from Wednesday. Evangelist Robert Marvin will be here with us, and he's a friend that we've seen before, so we look forward to having him with us on that day. And what else? We got birthdays this week. I don't see Byron back there. Is Perlito here? Well, there he is. Perlito's birthday, and we're going to make him pick up some money in the offering. Anybody else have a birthday today or this week? How about anniversaries? Birthday? Anniversary. 27th anniversary. Amen. Anything else? What's so funny? Brother Mike?
Let's sing happy anniversary first, okay? Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you. Several birthdays, so let's sing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Well, you know, there's all sorts of garbage out there on Facebook, and I can't stand half the political stuff on Facebook. I'm there trying to see pictures of people's kids and whatever it was they ate last night. But I saw one thing on there that was particularly appropriate this week. It said that us as Christians should be as excited about church as we should the Super Bowl. So, if he preaches a good sermon today and you consider it a win, you should dump a whole bucket of Gatorade over his head. We'll get him queued up outside and you guys can decide if it's a win or a loss. Gentlemen, if you'll come, we'll take our Sunday morning offering. We'll mention the track of the week. February is Heart Month. Time for your checkup. If you've been to the great physician for your checkup, and you can have your heart in all sorts of different states, so take a look at those. And there's no one particular track this week, so you can pick that up and find which one you think resonates with you that you can pass on to somebody else this February. And I was looking down here thinking there's someone for everyone and everyone, from children to the most mature. Are we softening the blow on age there? Yeah. All right. I like what you did there. Yeah. Well, I haven't reached any level of maturity, so I think I'm still in the children bucket there. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for all of those that are here today. We thank you for Brother Hansen being here and being our guest. And God, for those that have a special day this week, we pray you would bless them, give them great days there as well. And God, for these requests we've mentioned, there are only a few, but God, they're all near and dear to our heart, and we pray for them each, and we ask God for special blessings and healing and comfort where necessary. We pray now that you would take this offering, bless, multiply it, we pray, give us a great day this morning, and thank you for all you do for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, ladies. Take your hymnals one last time, please. Page 611. Stand with us once again. Page 611. He hideth my soul. That's page number 611.
A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. My soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me. Covers me there with his hand.
Okay, kids, you're dismissed. Sing that last.
When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand and covers me there with his hand.
Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. And now we have Brother Enoch to come sing.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled, sin and despair like the sea waves cold threatened the soul with infinite loss. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all my sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all my sin. Grace that is greater than all our sin.
Thank you very much, everybody. Appreciate the music. All right, this morning I'm going to try not to talk too fast. And I'm going to call upon some of your Bible knowledge, and then we'll turn to some stuff. But I've got a premise for you this morning, and it is this. Whereas it is indisputable that God records the sins of some of the finest men who ever lived, and whereas God could have simply made allusions to those sins rather than detailing them as He has done, and whereas God possesses unlimited intellect and insight, and a wonderfully graceful disposition toward man, He must have had perfect reason or reasons for recording the sins of good men as He has done. So that's my initial premise, that God records in His Word, and heard a little allusion to that this morning in Sunday school, but God takes some of the best men that ever lived, and He details their sins. Now, nobody's smarter than God or anywhere close to it. Nobody with the insight that He has or the pleasant disposition, grace, marvelous grace. So why is He doing this? Why is He doing it? Well, I'm figuring He's got to have a good reason. And that's my premise. Now I've got my conclusion. Now, it's my conclusion. We don't skip by the priesthood of the believer. You can all have your conclusions. Amen? I'll give you mine. God records the sins of man in order that those of us who are living after them can learn from their mistakes. I believe it to be wise to learn from the mistakes of others. I believe it to be foolish to drift into a posture where you must make every mistake in order to learn. You know, like they taught us in the military, they're talking about people and problems and all of that from the enlisted people. The little military humor is thrown in there, Larry. Anyway, they're teaching us about problems we might have personnel-wise and things, and they would put a caricature of a guy and say, never makes the same mistake twice. Makes all of them once. Now, if that's how we're going to learn, we're going to have a problem, aren't we? We cannot afford, they say experience is a dear teacher. It may be a good teacher, but it's a dear one. It costs you something to get all your knowledge from experience. We need to be able to learn from others. So that's what I'm going to say. It's foolish to drift into a posture where you must make every mistake in order to learn. Now, I'm going to take a quote-unquote good man as the first example of God's record-keeping, knowing that, apart from the Lord Jesus Christ, there never has been a good man. Now, my first authority on that, of course, my authority is the Bible, but my first quote on that, I guess you'd say, is from the Bible and from the Lord Jesus Christ. And a man came up and said, good master, and he said, why callest thou me good? There's none good but one, that is God. So very obvious, we've read our Bibles, there's none righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So when I say here's a good man, you understand what I'm talking about. He was a pretty good guy. Didn't say he was perfect. So with that disclaimer acknowledged, my first example and proof of my premise is a man after God's own heart, King David. God calls him a man after my own heart, of whom it is recorded that he lusted after a married woman when he himself was married, that he further initiated a relationship with her, that he subsequently committed adultery with her, and then in an attempt to hide his wicked sin, had her husband executed by the hand of the enemy, and all of this at David's own command that he gave to General Joab. So just to review that for a second and think a little more, David, the sweet psalmist of Israel, violated an active Israeli war hero's wife, injuring her reputation forever in the process. Now, I don't know what it's going to be like in heaven, forever in this life at least, because it's recorded in the Bible. Injuring her reputation in the process, sinning against an innocent man who was extremely upright in his behavior, and then failing to compromise Uriah's integrity in any way, he had this perfectly innocent and unknowing man killed. So Uriah is just rocking along through life, doing his duty in an exemplary manner. Meanwhile, one of the most upright men of the day is destroying him for no reason. And just for the record as well, the child that David fathered with Bathsheba died. So let's turn to 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 9. 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 9. Now, if you got a good night's sleep last night, this is going to be a good sermon. If you didn't, it's not my fault. 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 9. Now let's read carefully. 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 9. Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Okay? This is Nathan the prophet talking to David, and the word comes from God. Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with a sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with a sword of the children of Ammon. Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me, and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house, and I will take thy wives before thine eyes, and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of the sun. For thou didst it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun. And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. And God recorded the whole thing. I'm thinking of Numbers 32:23. Be sure your sin will find you out. Now, I want you to hold that thought while we veer off a bit. When we're born, we usually gain certain rights. It may be the right of citizenship. I'm not going to crack any jokes today, Adrian, about that. It may be the right of citizenship. It may be family rights. In terms of the new birth, we are sons of God. Those are major birthrights, I think we'd agree. Amen? In the Old Testament, the firstborn received a double portion. He had the birthright. Reuben was the firstborn of Jacob. Birthright. But, 1 Chronicles tells us this. Now the sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, for he was the firstborn, but forasmuch as he defiled his father's bed, his birthright was given unto the sons of Joseph, the son of Israel, and the genealogy is not to be reckoned after the birthright. And then there's a guy by the name of Esau. You're in 2 Samuel. Let's go back toward the future. Go back to Genesis 25. Go back forward to Genesis 25. There we go. Genesis chapter 25, verse 29. Isaac's son Esau. Did I say Jacob's? It's Isaac's son Esau. And the Bible says there, and Jacob sowed pottage. And Esau, now he's the firstborn, came from the field and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I'm faint. Therefore was his name called Edom, red. And Jacob said, sell me this day thy birthright. And Esau said, behold, I'm at the point to die. What profit shall this birthright do to me? And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he sware unto him. And he sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils, and he did eat and drink and rose up and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. As a result of this sale, in Hebrews 12:16, God calls Esau a profane fornicator. So putting all this together, my premise is that God includes the negatives, not just to criticize David, Reuben, or Esau, but so that we could all learn a positive lesson from a negative message. Now, one of the criticisms of we Bible-believing fundamental preachers is that we're just too negative. Well, God's pretty negative. Amen? I mean, a lot of negativity in here. You, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. Sodom and Gomorrah, boom, vaporized. Okay? Except in the case of his wife, and she was pillarized. Pilloried. But the thing is, I believe God is giving us, he's taking these negative events to give us a positive message. How's that sound, Mrs. Mitchell? Good. All right. Occasionally, people point out to me this negativity that I sometimes emanate. Anyway, God is giving us positive lessons from negative events. As born-again believers, we each have a birthright. And whereas Esau despised his, that's the actual word, he despised his birthright. And whereas David despised God's commandment, which God said meant that he was despising God. If you despise God's commandment, you're despising God. If you tell your son to take out the garbage or to mop the floor in the hallway, and he says, I'll think about it, Dad, he's despising you. And God says this word for word, he's despising God. And whereas Reuben did his own despising in his own way, these men were all in one manner or another despising their birthright. Now, here's God's positive message from the negative events. Now, I went to my good friend, dictionary.com, and I got the definition of despise. To regard with contempt, distaste, disgust, or disdain. Scorn or loathe. Now, we don't want to be in the position of scorning or loathing God, amen? And that's what happens if we despise our birthright. We've seen instances of it right here. Now, that's very strong language from God, amen? I mean, that's pretty rough language. He despised the commandment of God, David did. He despised God. Esau despised his birthright. God called him a profane fornicator. It's tough. Tough. Okay? So, strong language from God. Well, here we go. Number one, as Christians, we have our birthright. I'm talking to Christians. I'm talking to people that have received Jesus Christ. They've got a new birth. They're born into the family of God. The Bible says in John 1:12, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Now, I'm going to get into heaven because it's my house. Amen? My Father owns it. That song that the choir sings, I come on the merits of Jesus. And then the gate swung open wide. Is that how it goes, Carl? They welcomed me inside. Man, it's not what you know, it's who you know. And man, I'm born into the family of God. I'm a child of the King. I have a birthright, as does everyone that's received Jesus Christ as their own personal Lord and Savior. We've got mansions awaiting. We've got a new and glorified body we're going to get. We have victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil. And it's pretty hard to put a price or a value on that. But that's our birthright. Secondly, to not properly value that birthright is to place ourselves, our posterity, and our friends at grave risk, even including death. And we saw that in the case of David. We read a lot of this. Nathan said to David, "Thou art the man. Thus saith the Lord of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel." Boom. "I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul. I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would moreover have given unto thee such and such things." David, I gave you about everything, and if you wanted more, I would have given it to you. "Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with a sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon." We need to value our birthright and not get into those situations. Now, if we're not extremely aware of the value of the birthright versus the challenges that this world presents to us, we are likely to place insignificant things such as a morsel of meat. That's what God says about Esau. A morsel of meat. We'll take that morsel of meat and we'll value it over our birthright if you're not careful. And esteeming your birthright can come down to a matter of life and death. Esau said that he was at the point to die. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but that's what he said. And based on that evaluation, he decided his birthright was not that important. He said, "What profit shall this birthright be to me?" Now, I hope we're not walking around as Christians saying, "What profit is my birthright?" But that's what Esau said. Obviously, he did not esteem the words of God, God's mouth, more than his necessary food, as Job did. And obviously, he did not understand the possibility of what Mordecai expressed to Esther. Remember, Mordecai said to Queen Esther, he said, "Look, if thou therefore altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then there shall enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this?" This could have been Esau's test. You think you're going to die, so you sell the birthright. You despise it, when maybe God was going to deliver him some other way. I mean, the angels fed Jesus or took care of Jesus. They administered to him. He didn't eat for 40 days and 40 nights. But let's see, Elijah was fed miraculously. Jesus multiplied the loaves a couple of times, fed 5,000 and 4,000, plenty left over. So God, you don't know what God's going to do you? It may look like you're finished, but maybe you're not. Maybe God's just getting started. That might have been Esau's test. Did Esau deprive God the chance to show himself strong on Esau's behalf? What about Job again and his attitude? Job said, "Though he slay me, yet shall I trust him." Esau wasn't at that point, was he? "Hey, I'm finished. Guess I'll sell my birthright." But with all that God has given to us, as generous as he has been, we must all commit ourselves to placing the highest appraisal, if you will. We'll work Michael Hansen in here somewhere. He's a loan broker. We got a real estate agent here, Brother Hernandez, but I don't think we have another loan broker, do we? Okay, you need a loan broker, you go to Michael Hansen right here. He's the best. And if anybody should know about that, it should be me, because I refinance my house about every 3 months. every time with Michael Hansen. But anyway, we have to commit ourselves to the highest appraisal, if you will, of the value of our birthright. You probably know the value of your property. You probably know the value of your 401k. I know the value of mine. Zero. You probably know the value of your vehicle. But I hope you know the value of your birthright. Don't trade it for anything. It's your special birthright from God Almighty. And He values it higher than we can imagine. Why? It cost Him His precious blood to secure that birthright for you and me. And when we misappraise our birthright, we count the blood of the covenant an unholy thing. That's what we're doing when we misappraise that birthright. We're treading underfoot the Son of God if we do that. And in so doing, as Hebrews says, we do despite unto the Spirit of grace. In other words, we despise our birthright when that happens. All of those things are taking place. They go, yeah, man, I violated His commandment, but I got nothing against God. God said, wait a minute. You despise my commandment, you despise me. And when we despise it, what we're doing, we are regarding with contempt God Almighty. We are regarding with distaste God Almighty. Oh, man, this Christianity, kind of a burden. We can't let that happen in our minds. I'll misquote it, but David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. And I think I did not misquote it. But I'll tell you, I unlocked these gates a lot of times over the last 29 and a half years. And again, I opened them today. And I just thought how blessed I am to be able to open the gates of God's property. He's been so good to me. Bless me so much. We don't want to loathe God or scorn Christianity. And the Bible says that Esau, though he sought it carefully with tears, found no place of repentance. And he was rejected. And David besought God for the child and fasted and lay all night upon the earth, but the child still died. And on his deathbed, Jacob, Reuben's father, spoke ever so highly of Reuben, calling him my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity and the excellency of power. But then, Jacob continued, and he added this. He said, unstable as water, thou shalt not excel, because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, then defilest thou it. He went up to my couch. He said, man, that Reuben's a great guy. He's a power, he's a firstborn, the excellency of my strength, but he will not excel. He's unstable. Can't count on him. He's got all the gifts. He's got the works. But I don't know what he's going to do tomorrow. I don't know where he'll be next week. Defiling the birthright. Remember, God is not simply dishonoring these men. He's trying to tell us to be so proud of our birthright, to be so thankful of our birthright, to esteem it so highly that we would never loathe it or scorn it in any way. Because when we despise that birthright, when we despise God's commandments, we are in effect despising, loathing, and scorning God Almighty who gave His life for us. Now, somebody might be sitting here saying, preacher, man, I'm afraid it's too late for me. I'm going to be honest with you. I've already despised my birthright. And I believe God would say to you right now, neither do I condemn thee, go and sin no more. If you've been born again, you're still God's child, and He loves you with all of His heart. And He's throwing all this negativity out there. to give you a positive lesson. I love you. You're my child. Yeah, you messed up. Oh, yeah, you kicked over the milk bucket a couple of times. But let me tell you something. You belong to me, and I love you so much. Go and sin no more. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. Amen. Today's the first day of the rest of your service to God Almighty. You can confess your sins to God. You don't have to come to me. I'm not Father Mitchell. I'm the preacher. You can go to God and get everything squared away and get back on track for God. Amen. And if you've already confessed it, can I just say stop confessing it? How many times have you got to be forgiven? You're going to keep bringing it up and bringing it up and bringing it up. If God did that, you'd say he wasn't fair. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just, because he's just and the justifier, Romans tells us, to cleanse us, forgive us our sins, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's over, man. Don't carry it around anymore. Just be there and say, man, oh man, let me tell you something. Woo, baby, I'm a child of the King. I've got a birthright. I am so blessed, and I thank God for it. Well, boy, a lot of negativity there, preacher. Yeah, just to give us a positive message. He loves David. David's with the Lord right now. Amen? But he put it down there to talk to me and to talk to you. And say, look, treasure that birthright. Treasure your position in Jesus Christ. And that's my premise regarding God's positive message from negative events. Oh, God, thank you so much for your graciousness to us. So good to us. God, we don't condone sin. But God takes care of it. He paid for it. He knew all about your dirty little dark secrets before you were even born. When he died for everybody in this auditorium and everybody in the world, he knew all about their sins, and he knew all about it and went to the cross anyway. That's love. God, I'm so thankful for that kind of love. Am I undeserving? Absolutely. Was I undeserving then and since then? Absolutely. But I'm so thankful. And God, my commitment to you is that I want to really uphold and treasure and properly appraise that birthright that you have so graciously bestowed upon me. I'm blessed. Basically, everybody in this auditorium could say the same. I would simply say this. Make sure you have a birthright. Make sure to have a birthright, you got to have a birth. I'm talking about the new birth. I'm talking about the fact that when you receive Christ, you are born into the family of God with a spiritual birth. Sounds confusing, possibly, but it's very simple. That if thou should confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Doesn't get any simpler than that. When we take our trust off ourselves and put our trust in Jesus Christ, for our eternal destiny, our salvation, our relationship with him happens with a birth, not by works. God, when we do that, we have the greatest birthright that anyone could ever have. Thank you for it. God, as we have an invitation, bless, we pray. Thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.